a pretty sustained and dedicated organizing base where they can get people out into the streets. They can, pack the city hall and the city council chambers with people who are testifying and holding, elected leadership accountable. So that matters. So resourcing, investing in those efforts and sustaining that organizing is a critical ingredient. I think the other piece is an analysis of the policies and practices of the department, and being willing to actually change those policies and practices to do a couple of things. One, strengthening the use of force standards of the department. Two, strengthening the accountability structure within the department. And that's true both at the, we're seeing some departments begin to do that at the individual officer level through the use of early warning systems and using a predictive technology to actually identify which officers will be using force at higher rates or the next officer to shoot somebody and intervening before that happens. Also at the department level, establishing oversight structures that have the power to effectively hold police accountable and discipline officers and subpoena documents and witnesses in order to get to the bottom of misconduct cases and what happened. I mentioned earlier was the role of the Department of Justice in forcing departments to implement changes that they otherwise would not have. As I mentioned, many of the departments that have actually reduced rates of police shootings substantially over the past 6 or 7 years have been departments that have had a Department of Justice intervention. So Vice News did a great investigation of this, and they got access to all the police shootings data for, I believe, the 40 largest law enforcement agencies, 40 or 50 largest in the country. And that's what they found was that those departments like Oakland, like Seattle, like Chicago, like Baltimore, that had Department of Justice interventions, that were required to change their policies, were required to strengthen their accountability systems, actually did see some results from that, saw reductions in police shootings following those interventions. The problem is that, again, all of this is happening at different levels. So at the federal level now, with the current administration, they're not willing at all to engage in those investigations or those consent decrees. So we sort of lost that tool. Now it's at the state level. We're relying on AGs to do that. And they, except for in a few cases, have refused to do so. So it's a mix of things that are important, organizing, policy change, and then interventions from the federal government that have all come together in some places to get results.
So, a lot of your work in the area of police violence, it seems like it's motivated by a more overarching goal of, addressing structural racism in the United States. And we know that there is an element of structural racism in the way that police departments handle, use of force disproportionately in a way that negatively affects African Americans and other minority groups. So, while it's important to collect data and do rigorous analyses and present this to the public and policymakers, do you think that's enough to convince people to pursue change? It's still hard for some people to believe that racism is an issue in the United States, even today. So is there an ideological factor that makes arguments based on data insufficient on their own? And in your work, how do you see the two things, the activism and the addressing America's legacy of racism, working with your data analysis?
Yeah, so I mean, first of all, we don't have to convince everybody, right? I think this idea that everybody has to understand and acknowledge racism in order for us to make progress is just like not true, right? We've never been in a place where, like, across the board, people understood and rejected racism. It's always been hard fought. It's always been something where there has been an opposition that's been highly organized, that had a lot of people on their side who've been resisting any effort to move forward any type of racial progress. At the same time, I think we have more than enough people who are willing to not only accept that racism is real, but also willing to do something about it. We have more than enough people to actually make progress, right? And I think the challenge is less convincing new people. I mean, if you're not convinced by now, after all that's been happening, I don't think our resources are best spent trying to convince you, right? I think you are, by definition at this point, difficult to convince, even despite all of the both emotional and data-driven arguments that have happened over the past several years. at the same time, if you look at, you know, survey research, it's actually a majority of Americans that believe that racism not only still exists, but that we still need to implement further change in order to achieve racial equality in this country. And those numbers have been increasing over time since the movement began. You know, when the movement began, it was actually not a majority of Americans who believed that. Now it's about 59%. And we're talking about a shift of about 40 million white Americans and their attitudes and beliefs about this issue that have happened since the movement began. And that's important. Now the question is, how do we organize the people that we already have and the people that are already willing to listen so that we can actually build power together and achieve these changes? And that's an organizing challenge, right? It's a challenge of that you see in many different mass movements where you have millions and millions of people. You think about climate change, for example. I mean, you have billions of people who support the need to address climate change. And yet, you know, how many people are actively being organized and engaged in advocacy for climate justice on a daily basis? Like not even a fraction of that total number of people. It's the same for police violence. It's the same for other forms of gun violence. For any of these issues, immigration, same thing. There are always more people out there than are current that would be involved in the work, that are willing to get involved in the work, that might have unique skills and capacities that could add value to the work. More people that are interested in getting involved than are currently involved, or the existing sort of infrastructure or of organizations has the capacity to onboard. I think solving that problem is actually the more important problem than figuring out how to convince more people to get involved. I think people are already convinced. They're reaching out. They're sharing content. They want to get involved, but there are just not enough pathways for people to get involved in meaningful and actionable ways to address issues that are often complex and are localized. So like you may be interested in addressing police violence, but you know, in order to make progress on that in your community, that requires understanding what are the key levers of power and change in your city or in your county, and what are the key outcomes that need to be changed with policy. So it's different by community. In some places, you may actually have relatively lower rates of deadly force or police use of force in general, but much higher rates of arrests, in particular drug arrests and drug arrest disparities by race, or ticketing and fines and fees, civil asset forfeiture. I mean, there are a range of different dimensions to this problem. And so part of this is making information as accessible and actionable as possible to help people in each community understand how they can get involved in the most meaningful ways that are driven by an analysis of what are the biggest problems, and data is a tool to help us do that analysis.
All right, Sam, you've been very generous with your time. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Root of Conflict featuring Sam Sinyangwe. To learn more about the topics discussed on today's episode, visit policescorecard.org or mappingpoliceviolence.org. Special thanks to UC3P and the Pearson Institute for their continued support of this series. For more information on the Pearson Institute's research and events, visit thepearsoninstitute.org and follow them on Twitter.